Welcome to Clovermead Bees and Honey. My name is Chris Heemstra, and I'm one of the owners here with my wife, Christy Heemstra. And we have a lot of bees here. We say home to 24 million bees, 600 beehives. We have behind us, we have our log cabin where we have our store and where we sell our honey, and we welcome our visitors. Behind the log cabin, there's a train station, which we call the Bee Information Station, where people can come and take a self-guided tour, or we give a tour. Clovermead Bees and Honey, we are located in Hilmer, Ontario, which is about 2 hours from Toronto, and of course, Canada. All right, this is our store here, and here's our sales counter. There's our tank where we sell honey out of, and we have tanks in the back there with different varieties of honey.
Many people are asking questions about different types of honey. And I see here we have a few different types of honey. Chris, can you explain to us a little bit about colors and type of honey?
Okay. The flowers yielding different types of nectar are different colors. So what happens is, just like flowers produce different colors of pollen, oranges and browns and you name it, same with honey, they'll produce different color nectar, and the bees collect that. And so when you have a flower that is producing really light colored nectar, such as the clover, then you can see a very light colored honey. Now, if you have a buckwheat flower, which has got a very dark nectar, then you end up with a very dark, strong tasting honey. Now, there is exceptions to the rule. Sometimes you can have a very dark looking honey, but it has a very light taste. So there can be exceptions. The blueberry honey tends to be a little bit darker. And so each has its own characteristics. And we'll go over to the bee information station, which is through the door here. And just follow me. This is my grandfather in the Netherlands. He was a beekeeper, and these are his beehives. And this is my father here when he was a young boy. And my grandfather had six boys, and today four of the six boys are keeping bees. So it's definitely in the family. And yeah. Some people say we have sweet blood. This is the bee information station. And over here we have antique beekeeping equipment that my father's been collecting that over time. And on the floor here you can see straw skeps, which is the original way that people used to keep bees in the Netherlands, and also pioneers that came over to Canada, they kept them in straw skeps. When you're having foundation, plastic foundation, where the bees are building the honeycomb on, you roll flat sheets of wax through, and there's this honey cell shape is on that, and that rolls out and it imprints into the wax.
Into the wax, yeah.
And then the bees will build the cell on it. Now, they don't need this, but this helps them get a head start, because you're giving them a big chunk of wax. It's thick.
You're getting them foundation.
You give them a foundation to build on. That's right. Oh, okay. And so they call it foundation. The extractor, which is... This frame here has been broken, but it just slips in here, and then the beekeeper spins this, and the honey automatically flies out to the outside.
Honey will just come out.
And then there's a drain at the bottom, and just open the tap and let the honey out. So a lot of the equipment would have been from his era. I don't think any of the pieces on here are from him. When they immigrated from the Netherlands to Canada, that was 1952, I think. And I think all that stuff stayed behind. So. On the wall here, we have a lot of ribbons that my father has been winning over the years, entering the honey in various competitions. One of the honey competitions is in Toronto at the Royal Winter Fair, and he's won a bunch of different trophies and things there. Yeah, typically this is what it looks like inside the beehive. Now, we have the beehive stacked up on top of each other, and it's only a single frame thick. But the bees, they can go up to the top, and then from the top they can go out, and you can see there's a gray tube there where the bees are moving.
To this pipe. This is going outside.
Yeah, so they'll fly. So when a bee hatches out and it eats food and develops a little bit, then it will go out for its first flight, and it'll circle around and it will memorize where it is and in regards to the sun, and so it'll always come back to the same spot. The reason why they leave the hive is to go out and collect pollen, or they go out and collect nectar, or they collect propolis. And so the bees here, sometimes you can see bees, they're coming back with some orange pollen pellets on their back leg and their pollen baskets. And you can see shiny nectar underneath the wax cappings here. And you can see up here behind the bees, there's some brood, which they're keeping at 30 degrees Celsius, so they have to keep it incubated nice and warm.
So they keep basically the same temperature all the time?
They keep the same temperature, yeah. That's why this time of year is getting late. It's pretty soon October, and at night the temperature in the train station falls like to 11 degrees or even lower. And what happens is they can't keep the temperature here, so it's really difficult for them coming up soon. So we'll take them out, and that'll be it for the year.
Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit about the pollen?
Yeah, the pollen.
Pollen is very, very useful for humans, but very little known for the humans. Can you just explain a little bit about pollen?
Yep. The bees are collecting that pollen from the flowers, and the pollen from the flowers is getting on their body, and they're dusting it, and they're grooming it onto their back legs, so they can carry two pieces home at once. And when they bring it home, then they put it in the bottom of the cell, and the bees will eat that. And when they eat that, then automatically they produce royal jelly. And the royal jelly is fed to the queen bee, and that's why the queen is so so vigorous, laying eggs, and able to live for 3 years or longer in the hive. Yeah. And the bees, they also feed the royal jelly to the larva. Now, the pollen, if they didn't have pollen, then they can't produce the royal jelly, which they feed to the queen. So pollen is a very important staple of their diet.
Of their diet, of the bee's diet.
Yeah, and so a lot of minerals, a lot of vitamins, enzymes, nutrients, it's a complete diet. And people, they eat it as well, because they figure if they're missing something in their diet, then this is filling in the holes, and it gives people energy as well.
The queen is right here, and we mark the queen with a red dot, and that makes it easier for people to find it back when they're looking in the station here. Sometimes she's up a little bit higher, and then you can't find her, but today she's right here. And she's actually got, you see a circle of bees around her?
Yes.
And they call those the royal attendants. Mm-hmm. And so they're grooming her, and they also feed her, eh? They'll feed her the royal jelly. So you can see there's two bees at the front here, just above her head, and maybe one of them is feeding them. And if you're really close up, I don't know. But so this time of year, the queen is not laying as many eggs, which means the days are getting shorter, and they don't want to have a big hive of bees for the winter. They want to have numbers realistic, so that they can not have too much food eaten, and that they make it through till next spring. So the queen will not be laying as many eggs right now, but this is really a really nice picture here.
Chris, tell us a little bit about what type of bees we have here in the hive.
Okay, so we have here the queen bee, and then around her are all her children. Those are all her daughters. The queen lays the egg, and if it's a fertilized egg, then you get a worker bee or a female bee. The queen, when she doesn't lay a fertilized egg, then you'll get a drone bee, and sometimes it's not so easy to find a drone bee. This hive is not a gigantic hive, so you won't find as many drones, but a drone is a male, and their principal purpose is to mate with a young queen. So this queen, when she hatched out, and she was 7 days old or so, and the weather was beautiful, then she would go on a mating flight, and she'll be flying in the air, and a drone will come along, and it will mate with her, and she'll mate with five or six different drones during those first days, and then that's it. She doesn't mate ever again. She stores it in her body, and when she lays an egg, it's either fertilized egg or unfertilized egg. If they want to make a new queen, say this queen is getting tired, not laying very many eggs, not letting out strong pheromones, then they'll take a larva, and they'll feed the larva extra royal jelly, and then that larva will grow big, and it will have an extra large cell. And when that queen cell hatches out a new queen, then she'll either put up with the old queen, or she'll just kill the old queen.
Just sting
it.
Just get rid of
it. Yeah. The most important thing for the colony is to have a vibrant young queen. That's really important.
Tell us a little bit about life of the bees, Chris. What's the life expectancy for the worker bees? What's the life expectancy of a queen bee?
Okay. A worker bee, in the summertime, they're working. And they're flying, and they're not really, they do rest a little bit, but they're basically going 24 hours a day. Their wings wear out, their body gets tired, and 6 weeks, that's it. It's game over.
So basically the worker bee is living approximately 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And that's about 40, 45 days.
Yeah, and that's in the summer. Now in the winter, because the bees are just hibernating, they cluster together like a football or a soccer ball, and then the bees aren't so busy, and then they can live for the entire winter, and before spring, then usually they raise new bees to replace the old workers from the fall. So.
And what's a life expectancy of the queen bee?
Okay. The queen bee, she can live for 3 years, sometimes 5 years. I think the world record is like 7 years. The queen, when she's getting older, then she's not laying as many eggs per day, which reduces the size of the colony, and then the bees will replace her. The drone is kind of interesting. The drone will live probably 6 weeks, 8 weeks, even longer. But in the fall, when the days are getting colder and the bees, they say, well, the mating season is over, we don't need any drones, then they push the drones out of the beehive. And the drones actually freeze with the cold weather, and that's the end of the drone. So maybe 8 weeks for the drone.
Okay, and what is the approximate number of eggs that queen bee lays each every day in a season?
Yeah, during the middle of the summer, I would say she can lay maybe 1,200, 1,500 eggs in a day. And as the days get shorter, then the number goes down. So now it's October, so she probably doesn't lay more than 500 per day, just a little patch of eggs every day. And when the days start getting longer again in March, then she starts picking up the pace again. And so say November, December, when there's no flowers, then she almost completely quits laying eggs. There's nothing, depending on, of course, the temperature.
So. How do we keep bees over the winter time when it's so much cold and snow? So how we protect them?
Yeah, it's pretty amazing what bees can do. What we do as beekeepers is we have the box, it's a single box, and we have a sock, which is it's an insulated plastic sleeve that slides over top of the hive. And then on top of the frames, we have a pillow, which is also insulated, and we lay that on top. So the heat from the bees is reflected off the insulation and goes back down again. The bees don't try to keep the whole box warm, they actually only try to keep the cluster warm. And that cluster moves through the hive, and as they move through the hive, they eat the reserves, their stores of honey.
Yes.
And by spring, they're running low on reserves, but then there's new flowers again, and away they go. So we take the wraps off in the spring, usually in May, and the bees are flying, and we never lock them in completely. We always let them have an entrance for fresh air to come in and for moisture to get out. Moisture is actually a big problem, not the cold weather is a problem. These are amazing insects. They can adapt to the cold weather. They're from the tropics originally, but they can also keep the hive cool in the summertime. If you put a beehive on a hot black asphalt, they can keep that temperature at 30 degrees Celsius.
They keep it always at that temperature.
They keep it at that temperature.
Yeah. Normally for a beehive of four frames, how many bees are normally working inside and living inside with the queen or one queen or more queens?
Yeah, and the beehive is normally, the population is always changing. So in the winter, it's getting lower, it's going 15,000, 20,000. And then as the days get longer, then it grows 30,000, 40,000, 50,000. And maybe in the middle of summer, it's up to 60, 70, 80,000 bees just in that one beehive.
In one beehive.
Yeah, and so they have a big worker force when there's a big amount of flowers, and that helps them collect the reserves that they need for the winter. And as winter comes closer, then they try to bring the population back down, because if they have all these bees and there's no flowers, that's a lot of people eating.
No fun.
They're fighting, I think, instead. So they collect what they need, but the population is always changing.
And then is there a one queen bee per hive, or it's more queen bees?
There's always one queen bee per hive. Sometimes if there's an old queen and a very young queen, then she puts up with the old queen. But normally if they're raising new queens, those queens will fight with each other. And the strongest queen, she is going to sting the other bees to death, or the other queens to death, and that's how she determines that she's the new queen.
That she's she's in charge.
Yeah, and the queen bees, they don't have barbs on the stinger, so when they sting it in, they can pull it back out, and it's business as usual. But a worker bee, when they sting another bee, then the barb stays behind. The stinger stays in there, it hooks in like a fish hook, and it pulls part of their body out, and the bee dies.
Very good, thank you. Yeah.
The royal jelly, it's a product from when the bees are eating a lot of pollen and nectar. And there's a mandibular gland that secretes the royal jelly, which they feed to the queen. But they also, all the larvae in the beehive, as the bee is developing, it's always, the larvae stage needs to have royal jelly. So the larvae, it's floating actually in a little, the bottom of the cell has actually got royal jelly in the bottom. So the larvae is eating royal jelly. And the royal jelly is very nutritious, of course, because that's how you end up with a full-grown bee. But the bees naturally are secreting it when they're collecting pollen and eating nectar. So,
thank you.
Some people, they think the queen, while it hatches out and it has a red spot on it, but it actually doesn't have a red spot on it. The beekeeper puts a mark on it, and that way he knows that this is very easy when he's pulling the frames out. Hey, there's the queen, I see it. It's like a big flashing light for him. Also, he can tell what year the queen was hatched, because if he marks it this year and next year the queen in the hive doesn't have a red mark on it, then he knows that they've changed queens while he wasn't looking. Or if he knows that in 2007 he marked all his queens red, and then in 2008 he still has a few red queens, then he knows that those are queens are from 2007.
From 2007.
Yeah. Okay.
Can you tell us now what we're going to do?
Yeah. First thing, beekeeper's most important tool is his smoker. So we're going to make a fire inside the smoker to create some smoke. So we'll do that. And the reason why we're using smoke, it's not because I like it so much, but because it keeps the bees calm.
So. And this practice was only, what, a couple hundred years old?
Smoking. Yeah, they used to use smudge pots, like, so the beekeeper would be breaking into a hive, and then they would put a pot downwind and burn something in there, and the smoke would keep the bees calm. And they, in the jungles, when they're harvesting honey from trees, they usually have a torch with lots of smoke on it.
Uh-huh. This is very common. This is very unique.
So, anyways, this thing's really really smoking now. And so the next thing the beekeeper wants to do is he wants to smoke the entrance of the beehive. So I just blow. I'm going to blow some smoke inside there.
This is done in order to get the honey out.
Well,
this
is the reason. Any time that you want to open up the beehive is a good time to smoke the hive. Just you just do it as a matter of course. Now inside the hive, honey is off, and we have this blue pad they put it on yesterday, and this is our part of our organic mite treatment. So inside the pad is formic acid, food grade formic acid, and it has a smell, and the smell goes into the beehive and it knocks the mites off the bees, but it doesn't kill the bees. It doesn't smell good. You can smell. Yeah. You want to smell it?
This is to protect the bees from the mites.
From the mites, yeah.
Yes.
And it's organic, treatment. And so we try to do everything in an organic matter here because, well, people have to eat this food. And it's also good for the bees long term.
Yes, it's health expectancy for them, and life expectancy for them much longer.
Okay, so we'll just take this ring off. This is just it's for the space for the pad. Normally it's not on there. Okay, so here's a typical beehive inside. You'll see 10 frames all the way across. And the bees are building wax on top, in case they want to store some extra, and we can scrape that off. Not important. So then, next thing we want to do is pull up a frame. And so I just...
Can I give
it in? Yeah, you have to be really careful. And then try not to have any of the bees getting squished, and you pull it out. So, so here you can see on the inside, there's a larva.
This is the larva here.
Yeah, the larva there. And because of the formic acid, then that's also, sometimes it's... yeah, it's affecting the larvae as well as the mites, and that's just a natural thing once in the spring.
So how many bees would we have here in this hive, Chris, normally?
This hive here right now is probably maybe 15, 20,000 bees.
15, 20,000 bees.
Yeah. Wow, so every, pull up a frame.
Yes.
You can see all of the bees.
Yes.
You can see the fresh, the fresh honey, it's kind of shiny on the frame.
Yes, it's right
in there. Yeah, and then you also will see, if I just open the cell up a little bit, you see the pollen in the bottom, there's orange and there's yellow.
Yeah, this is the pollen, how it's collected, yes.
Yeah, and they store it right like that. Yeah. So when these bees are hatching out from me, these brown spots, there's a bee here.
So this is basically new bees being hatched.
Yeah,
the seal wax.
Yeah, so when they hatch out, and the first thing they can do is eat pollen, eat some nectar, and away they go, they're off to the races. Yeah, and I can shake the bees off. 1, 2, 3, and then
you can see really how clear. Much yeah. How much is there.
Yeah. So they've got a lot of nectar in the cells right now, and it's good because this box here we like it to weigh maybe 80 pounds before winter starts.
To get about 80 pounds of honey.
Yeah, it has to have that much weight, otherwise they're going to run out of food before spring. Mm-hmm. The queen is somewhere in this hive. It's like looking for a wall to open.
because there's 20,000 bees, and one of these frames she's walking on there. Let's have a quick look. You see a lot of pollen on that frame.
Yes, lots of pollen here. It's, it's, and you can see the color, a different color of the pollen. And this here is
that's capped over honey. So
it's a sealed honey is already full there.
Yeah. So when it's getting full, then you can see how they're starting to build the edges over.
Yes.
And when the edges are built over, then it's capped. So we call it capped. So
yes.
I can scrape, and you see all the honey. Oops, I'm
drowning
a bee
there. You can see.
But
it's full of honey.
And the bees you'll watch in a minute. They'll all come around, and then they'll start licking up the mess, and then they'll put a layer of wax over it to fix it.
Right away.
Yeah, if I come back tomorrow, you won't notice that I was there.
So basically, they will seal that.
They'll fix it.
But amazing how much pollen they collect.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. That's because of the value of the pollen.
Mm-hmm. And some of the pollen, they're going to put a layer of honey over, and they won't touch it until when the days are getting longer and there's still snow on the ground, then they'll start eating that pollen, and they'll start producing royal jelly, and they'll start raising new bees. So it's amazing, when the snow is still blowing, the bees are keeping this 30 degrees Celsius in here. And
Even though
it's outside, it's really cold. And they use the carbohydrates from the honey as their reserves
for producing
energy.
Keeping the heat.
It's for warming up and keeping the heat, yeah. You can see here is a bee with pollen on its legs.
Here is a bee with the pollen carrying both legs.
Both legs, yeah. Otherwise they're flying lopsided, eh?
Yeah, it's... It's good. So she didn't deposit it yet.
No, I don't know why. She's probably looking for the right spot. Probably.
How much honey we get from frame like this, guys?
Yeah, that frame there would probably hold about 8 pounds of honey.
8 pounds.
Yeah, but we don't take honey out of the box. This box, we always have a queen excluder, which keeps the queen downstairs, and then we put another box on top with frames in it, and that's our honey box.
That's honey
box.
So
whatever the bees collect here is theirs. It stays the one. But right here is what a queen cell looks like. So you can see when they're getting tired of their queen and they're going to replace her.
Yes.
They feed a larva extra food and they grow an extra large cell. And you can see here the lid.
Yes.
That the bee chewed off the edge and then it hatches out.
So this is basically where they produce new queen.
Yeah.
For their
hive.
Colony.
Yeah. So, but this one here, it's very new. It's normally you don't even find it with one of these attached to it.
How about this one here, the smaller one?
That one's one that never worked out. They'll just leave it there.
Oh, they started and didn't work it out.
Yeah, but they'll, like this one here, will eventually, they'll just tear it down and they'll build a new one if they're raising a new queen sometimes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's very, very interesting.
Yeah, so this frame just hangs in here. It doesn't actually touch the bottom of the box.
Uh-huh.
So the bees can walk underneath and back up and can walk
across. And so basically they can circulate.
Yeah. Can go anywhere they
so
want.
You can see the space between the frame is just enough for the bees to
squeeze through, yeah.
To go through and to do their routine work.
Yeah, and the queen she can go across any one of these frames and lay eggs. It's not it's not just limited to one frame.
To one frame, yeah.
Yes, you
do. Okay. That's very good. You have a very unique hive here, Chris. Maybe we can just touch this a little bit.
Okay. This is actually a tree. It's a part of a major tree trunk. And so you can see the hole here where the bees are going in and out. And inside they've built all their own honeycomb. And these bees have been in this tree stump here for 3 years. And you can see, well, there's quite a bit of honeycomb built up in here.
Yes.
And in some of the honeycomb, you can actually see the honey in there if you get the right angle.
Uh-huh.
And so they'll survive naturally. I don't insulate it or anything. I just let it be for the winter.
So how many bees approximately would be in this?
A tree like that, it'll be the same thing where the hive would grow. So during the summer, it can go up to 50, 60,000 bees in there. And they can produce maybe over 100 pounds of honey inside that thing. But we don't take any away, it just stays in there. And you can also see a lot of propolis, like this brown running down the side here, that's all propolis. And here is propolis as well.
Yes.
And get some of my hive tool.
You can see.
Yeah.
And it's propolis is...
It's a resin the bees, they collect from the trees, and then they mix in some wax. And I'm not sure exactly what else they do to it, but if you have a cut, and you put propolis on your bandage, you put that over top, then you'll never get any...
It's basically antibiotic.
It won't. No bacteria can live with it. In the hospitals where they have resistance to antibiotics, they can use propolis.
They use propolis for that.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm just plugging in. This is the electric knife. And I've got some frames of honey that we took out of the beehive earlier. And so what we want to do is
The bees, when the cell is full of honey, then they put a capping layer over top of it. And before we can spin the honey out of the cell, we have to cut that wax layer off. So I've got this knife. It's almost like a lid on a container. Like it's supposed to keep it from getting moisture in it. And so the bees, when they're wintering, they're going to walk on top of the frame and they'll take the capping off and then they'll eat it. So it's just think of it like a lid on a jar.
And is this basically a frame full of honey, Chris?
Yeah, some of these cells down here, they're not completely full. They're they have to be filled up all the way and then they'll put a lid on it.
But it's a very good amount of honey here.
Yep. So if you watch your finger there, then we'll just slide this right up here. So the knife is nice and warm. It helps cutting through the wax.
So now we are removing wax, layer of wax.
The layer of wax is being removed. And the layer of wax, we can melt that down. There's some, by my feet, there's some bars of wax that we melted.
Yes.
It doesn't really look like much right now, but
wow,
you can see all the wax, all the honey underneath the...
So this is full of honey.
Yeah. And whatever I miss with the knife, I can just scratch it. If I don't scratch it, then what happens is the honey won't fly out when we run it through the extractor. So we'll turn this frame around.
Okay.
And then hold it here.
Yeah, let me hold it so you can...
Okay.
You can just...
I'm going to try not to cut your fingers off.
No problem.
All right.
So it smells so nice.
Yeah, the knife is nice and warm.
Oh,
and that helps.
The wax and honey, like mixed together, it smells so nice.
So we'll just slide that down. And there's a big chunk there. This thing here is called our extractor. And inside there's some frames that we extracted. I'll just take those out. And the one hasn't been spun yet. I think it's quite heavy, so we'll just slide it over. I'll set this one aside. And then I'm just going to...
We just tasted a little bit, so I hope you don't mind.
We'll write you a bill later on. No. We'll just set that here, and then close it up again. And the same thing with the other side. Screen in there, right? This just has to be locked into place. And then the main thing is to do is that we turn it on. So it will start spinning. I have to put the lid down in a second. It's a little bit heavier on the one side than the other side, so you can see that, there it goes. So you can get the idea. If I leave it up, then the honey will start flying out. So if you listen, you'll hear the honey hitting the extractor in a second.
So this is the honey spinner, basically.
Yeah.
So that's where the honey is separated from the wax, from the comb.
Yep. Okay, so anyways, after, we'll just turn it off for a second. I'll show you what it looks like inside. You'll see the honey dripping down. It still has to spin for a while. It usually goes for about 15 minutes, 10 minutes.
Wow.
Depends how the honey is. Okay, so I'm going to turn it on. And I don't know if you have to give it a help. It's going to go. Okay, so after the honey's been spinning out, you can open the tap and slide that up. So you can see the honey coming out. You're going to see little bits of wax that are going to be floating in there, the wax cappings that we cut off. You can see the wax. And so the honey goes through the straining cloth, and the wax that's left behind on top, we can use that again and melt it down. Basically, the only thing different between right now and with this demonstration is that this is a small strainer. Upstairs, we have a big strainer, and it goes directly into our honey tank, which is where we fill our containers from.
That's right, on this video.
Yeah. And they're always welcome to come to our farm if they wish. Our farm is open 6 days a week, and they can come here during the day and have a tour on their own, or if they want to make special arrangements, we can give them a tour like you just had.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris.
Bye-bye.
Kindly.
Yeah.